Good morning. Great to see everyone this morning. We're glad to have you in the house. And for those of you who are with us online, great to have you with us as well. We have some pretty amazing things going on. Great to see the McClures here with us again this week. And so praise God for that. If you haven't heard, Luke Middleton, which is Eric and Susan's grandson, that's Matt's boy, in Louisiana, had a single car accident a few days ago. He may get to go home today. Praise the Lord for that. He was comatose a few days ago for, I think you said, 36 hours, and so now he actually may get to go home. So praise the Lord for that recovery. I want to continue to pray for him and in his healing as he goes forward from here. You've probably watched everything that's on the TV now is about all of the unrest that's going on within our country. You saw the videos over and over and over again with the gentleman, Mr. George Floyd. As a result of that and other things just kind of kicking up, crazy unrest, and it's hard to limit the number of cities that are involved here. I was reading through, must have been over 20 cities that were significant enough to have mentioned in the news. It's just crazy, and today I want to pray for us and for our country, just all of the things going on. Not only was it COVID that was the big topic and certainly is still on our lips today, but also now just all of the unrest and the violence and riots and things going on. So I'm going to start us out with a quick prayer, and then the team will lead us off in some music. So let's go to the Lord. Father God, I'm so thankful for today and for each day. Father, we're so conscious of the things that are going on in our country right now. We pray for peace. We pray for unity. We pray, Father, we're not going to talk about justice and all those things. We're praying for a revelation that these people can know you and they can focus on you and know Jesus Christ as their Savior. I pray that would be a widespread, just a sweeping of your word and your presence in these people's lives, that their hope is not about what's going on around them, but their hope is in you and their eternal salvation and eternal life is through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Father, we come to you as a body and lay down at your feet and just pray for our country and pray for those people who are affected by this. Many businesses that have been burned, many people who've been hurt. And Father, we pray for your guidance throughout this process. And I pray for a sense of peace for our country. We ask all these things in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
You would go ahead and stand and sing with us as we worship. First one's called Here I Am to Worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay on my head, I will sing with the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. So good with every
What a powerful name.
Salvation in your name, and whatever comes our way, Lord, you are the steady rock that doesn't move despite everything else falling around. God, truth only comes from you and you alone. I pray that we can hold true to that and hold on to that. Understand that there's power in the truth. Pray that we don't look to the world for truth anymore, God, and that we can look to you and you alone.
We're going to continue our study in the book of Ephesians this morning. If you would, turn to Ephesians chapter 6. Susan is still at home recovering from surgery, but we both want to thank all of you for all the prayers on behalf of our grandson and our family. And it is certainly evidence of how much love is here, but his recovery is also evidence of God's mercy and the power of prayer. So as we begin our study this morning, let's begin in verse 12 as we begin our reading. We're going to read 12 through 15. For we're not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers of this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so that you'll be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then, after battle, you'll be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. It's very evident what is going on in our country. It's very evident that we're not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but we're fighting against the unseen world. This disturbance, this rioting, this looting, this killing, and the things that led up to it, all of it has its roots with the evil one. It gives us a visual picture, doesn't it? This is a Jesus problem. People don't have Jesus that act like that. They may say they do, but they don't. Because that doesn't have anything to do with Jesus, does it? In verse 15 is where the bulk of our lesson is today. As Tom and Garth had brought forth Garth had talked about the belt of truth and Tom the breastplate of righteousness. Today we talk about the shoes as being a part of the armor of God. He said, for shoes, put on peace that comes from the good news or the gospel, so that you will be fully prepared. I want to read to you several different versions of this verse, verse 15. New American Standard says this, and after having shod your feet with preparation in the gospel of peace. New Century Version, verse 15. On your feet wear the good news of peace to help you stand strong. Amplified Bible. And having shod your feet in preparation to face the enemy with firm-footed stability and promptness and readiness produced by the good news of the gospel of peace. Peace. Peace is a word that we don't really understand, I'm afraid, in most cases. And we're talking about peace is the shoes we're to wear. Well, this idea of shoes is something in which we all can identify with. We seem to have shoes for every occasion. We think we have to have a whole lot of shoes, some of us. Different colors, different styles. We have dress shoes. We have work boots. We have ball cleats, running shoes, casual shoes, basketball shoes, dance shoes. There are all kinds of shoes for different occasions. Yet Paul is talking here about some shoes that we should never take off our feet. He said, have your feet shod. Have your feet prepared. Have your shoes on. Be ready for battle when you have the right shoes on. As I can recall playing football and baseball and wearing cleats, without the cleats, I would slip and fall when I was playing. Without the cleats, I'd get knocked off my feet. And so the cleats were a big part of what I had to put on for when I went out there to participate. But yet that's one of the things that we fail to see, that we need the shoes that God has provided with us, the shoes of peace, if you will. These shoes are for stability, to be able to stand firm. And Paul has been using this phrase, stand firm, throughout Ephesians. And here he says, you need the right kind of shoes on to stand firm. And God is addressing here how peace, God's peace, confirms our direction. And that's one phase that we just don't seem to understand. See, the goal of the enemy is to knock us down. And we all have been knocked down. Our feet slip, and we get knocked off our feet, and we are not prepared. We fall down when we don't stand firm. Sometimes it comes out of nowhere. It knocks you off your feet. And we need these shoes on to help us stand firm and grip. What happened to us or our family, you get a phone call 1:20 in the morning. It's not going to be good. And my son calls and tells us what is going on as he's driving. He's got to drive 100 miles to see what is going on with his son. And he told me later as he was driving, as he was shaking, he pulled over on the side of the road about halfway, and he felt a peace come over him. He felt a steadiness, and he felt like things were going to be okay. And I know that was God's gift to him. But prayer was going on in our family at that time. That's what kind of peace I'm talking about. That no matter what the circumstances, no matter what you're faced, that peace comes over the situation, that you know God's in control no matter what. And yet, panic doesn't ensure, peace ensures. But do we enter each day realizing that we're under attack? And each one of us is going to be attacked. It's not a matter of if it's going to happen. It's a matter of when. It is going to attack. Tony Evans said this about spiritual warfare. The essence of the attack is to keep God's blessings, purpose, will, and provision from being manifested in your life. Satan causes chaos to make us turn from God instead of to Him. That's his objective. To cause us pain. And here's a statement I want to share with you that it took a long time in my life to understand this. But Satan can't take your salvation. He can't take your salvation, but he can make you a miserable Christian. He can make you miserable if you allow him to. He can't keep you out of heaven, but he can make you have hell on earth. That's what his objective is to God's people, to make you suffer if you allow him to. if you allow him. His goal is to keep us feeling in a constant state of despair and defeat. To make you feel defeated mentally, emotionally, physically, every other way. So Paul is urging us to put on the armor of God. And at this point, verse 15, he gets put on the right kind of shoes. And that is the shoes of the peace of the gospel. So when I think about peace, I think about the opposite of it. The opposite of peace is anxiety and turmoil. That's the opposite. But we look at a biblical definition, and every time peace is talked about in Scripture, it's talked about it, there's a calmness, there's a tranquility of the soul in the midst of the most difficult circumstances. You know, and we see a lot of verses dealing with this idea of tranquility and peace in Psalms as David goes through his trials. But think about it. A calmness and tranquility in the midst of the most difficult circumstances. Are you able to sing praises to God when you're being attacked? Are you able to sing praises, have a song in your heart when the most difficult of things are happening to you? That's not easy to do. And it's certainly not easy to do if you have no peace. It's the idea God's peace carries you through. And it's hard to have a song in your heart. It's hard to have that feeling because we're human beings. But yet God said, I can do that for you. I can do that for you. And I can still have tranquility and calmness in my heart in the midst of chaos. How I used to prepare a lesson is I usually handwrite it out and then I spend time typing it out. So I'm going through it again. Friday is when I'm doing this. That I'm typing this out because I'm not sure if I'll be here Sunday or not. Now I have to have this ready for somebody to pick up the slack. But going through this lesson reinstilled in me how important all this is because I got a peace from it, from the Scripture and from praying through this. It's not just a concept to try to grasp. It's a real part of life that God wants us to have His peace. It's real. It's as real as His love is. So we look at Philippians 4 and verse 17. Paul writes this, then you'll experience God's peace which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Some versions say a peace that surpasses all understanding. But this peace that God has for us exceeds anything that we can understand. It goes beyond. And it said it will guard our hearts, it'll guard our minds, it will protect us. But the peace of God is what we experience when we're led by the Holy Spirit. What's going on in the streets of Minneapolis and Atlanta and all these other cities, that's not being led by the Spirit, I'm telling you. Those are people not led by the Spirit. They're being led by demons. That's what the devil has caused. From the murder of that boy, that young man, to all this chaos out there. It's the work of the devil. That's what we can see. When we're attacked, we don't always see it that coming toward us. But he says, when you're led by the Spirit, you're going to experience peace that exceeds anything you can understand. And we can't understand true peace without the Holy Spirit in our lives. Can't happen. Understanding Jesus is what gives us peace. And when our world falls apart, We don't fall apart with it because we have Jesus. It's the peace he's talking about. If worry and anxiety has become your norm, if that's your normal way of living, always in worry and always in anxiety, and you move from one worry to the next, you don't have your shoes of peace on. It's not there. You're missing a part of the armor of God. And I'm not talking about being human here, because we all have things that happen that cause us anxious and that cause us worry from time to time. Believe me, no. But yet, I'm talking about worry becoming a way of life, anxiety becoming a way of life, that you never see the glass half full. You're always seeing it half empty. Because there's so many things going wrong in your life. So the question is, peace your norm or worry and anxiety your norm? God wants peace to be your norm. Jesus said this in John 14, verse 27. I'm leaving you with a gift. Peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give, the gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. See, Jesus was on his way to face the cross when he said this to his disciples. He said, I am leaving you with a gift. Peace of mind and heart. Not the peace that the world gives, because that's going to be temporary, isn't it? Because people are always seeking something that gives them relief in the world. Relationships. Drugs. Pleasures. It's all temporary. It doesn't last. But Jesus wants to give us something that is not temporary. Something that is eternal. And his change comes from the inside out. The world wants to change us from the outside in. Outside in changes are temporary. Because they don't reach the soul. They don't penetrate the heart. They make us feel good for a little bit. But what Jesus wants to do is change us from the inside out. And what happens on the inside is going to affect how we are on the outside. Because when we're full of worry, stress, and anxiety, what happens to our bodies? They start to break down. Do they not? They break down, but when we are healed we have the peace from the inside out, we rest better. We feel better. Bill is here, Margaret here this morning. Bill's got a great testimony. Great testimony of what God has done in his life. He's given Bill peace. And he's sitting there nodding about the inside out. He knows. He's experienced this. You see, God wants to do something special in our lives, and that's to give us peace and joy and true happiness. But yet we seek it from so many different ways, and we seek it with our flesh. So here's the question. Have you put on the shoes of peace? Going back to verse 15 of Ephesians 6, for shoes put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. Without the gospel, without being in God's word, we will not be prepared when we're attacked. The peace that Jesus gives us is the good news. And to understand Jesus is to understand the gospel. So if you were to ask, what is the gospel? Most answers are this. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's a pretty standard answer, isn't it? And it is those things. But it's just not that. It's more. Those things, the death, burial, and resurrection, are what Jesus did to save us from our sin and allow us to be able to come to God, and he accept us as his children. We have salvation. And when a person accepts and trusts Jesus as their Savior, they have salvation. But it's more for us after we become His child. The gospel is the good news of peace. Romans 5, verse 5. This hope will not disappoint us because God's love has been poured out in our hearts through His Holy Spirit who was given to us. Now look at verse 8. But God proves His own love for us while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, since we have now been justified by His blood, will we be saved through Him from wrath? For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of His Son, how much more, having been reconciled, will we be saved through His life? And he ends this in verse 11 saying, and not only that, but you also can boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom now we have received this reconciliation. We tend to understand these points, but we skip over, it says, we will be saved by His life. Getting to heaven is an important part of the gospel, but there's more. The resurrection delivers us to life. Jesus said, I will give you life and I will give it to you more abundantly. The gospel of life. It gives us life. We're saved eternally, but we're not to live a life that is miserable and full of anxiety and full of worry. It is to be a life full of peace. The peace of God. The happiness that peace brings. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23 is one of these verses that you need to highlight, you need to embed it in your memory. But this is what God's peace does. Now may the God of peace make you holy in every way, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be blameless until our Lord Jesus comes again. We have been made holy. We have been sanctified. We have been set apart as God's children. So as being God's children, He sets us apart and He wants to do something special for us beyond what's going to happen in heaven. He wants us to have the peace of assurance that we have God now. That God is in our life right now. And when we have that peace, we don't want to be a part of the world. We don't want to join in on what the world does. We want more of Jesus. We want more of what He has to give. We want more of what He can do for me. It's more because He says, I'll give you more. It's about the more. It's more. Peter said this in 1 Peter 1 and verse 2. God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and His Spirit has made you holy. As a result, you have obeyed Him, have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. May God give you more. May God give you more and more grace and peace. May He give you more. Because you are His child, because you have been saved. And he said this in 2 Peter 1 and verse 2. May God give you more and more grace and peace as you grow in the knowledge of our God and our Lord Jesus Christ. May God give you more. That's what the gospel is to us as Christians. It's more. We have been saved by the blood of Jesus. We are cleansed from our sin. We are forgiven from our sin. But God is going to give us more. More grace. More peace. And too many times we're just so interested in when somebody becomes a Christian. Were they baptized? Were they immersed? Okay, now they're good, so let's go on. Wait a minute. That's just the beginning. God said, I want to give you more. More. I've saved you, but I want to give you something more. Being saved is not the end, it's the beginning. It's the beginning of this journey. Jesus wants to fix us from the inside out. He wants to instill in us His grace, His love. And we have to look at life the way that God wants us to. We look at your own life. There's life before Jesus and there's life after Jesus. There's life before grace and there's life after grace. I had no peace without Jesus. And I thought I knew Jesus, but I certainly didn't have any peace before grace because I didn't understand the concept of grace. So I know Jesus, He's my Savior, but I knew nothing of the more. Because everything was based on works. The way I was taught. And what Jesus is telling me is, you know me, I want to give you more. You know me, I've saved you, but now I want to give you more than that. You say, how can there be more than salvation? That's God. That's God. There's more. I need to let the Holy Spirit loose in my life to get the more. The goal of the Holy Spirit is to release the DNA of Jesus in my life. You know what the DNA of Jesus is in my life? Look up here on the wall. It's the fruit of the Spirit. Right up here. It's the fruit of the Spirit. It's the DNA of Jesus Christ in our life. The Holy Spirit is in our life to release Jesus in our life. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Galatians 5. That is the more. That is the more. And if I want this to happen, I got to submit. I got to let the Holy Spirit take over, because if my mind agrees with the Spirit, change is going to happen. But if my mind disagrees with the prodding and leading of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit will not release anything. I got to agree. I have to allow. And then the Holy Spirit will partner with me in agreement with my mind and my soul in agreement. And then He can do great, great things. The change takes place because I'll have peace. And I'll get the more. The gospel has related what Jesus has accomplished. But He says, you've got to let my helper, the Holy Spirit, work. You've got to allow the Spirit to lead. And He said, put on the shoes of peace. Put them on. Shod your feet with preparation. When everything looks dismal, and all the things that we run into that bring us worry come along. Sickness, cancer, trauma, loss of job, finances, family issues. The list can go on. But in the midst of where everything looks like it's falling apart, we need to retreat and listen to God. And pray, Lord, give me this more you're talking about. Give me this peace. Give me more of your grace. Again, Philippians 4 and verse 17. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. It can overcome all those things that make life look like it's impossible. He will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. So here are the facts. His peace will guard your hearts and your minds as you live in Christ Jesus. As you live in Christ Jesus. When He says put on your shoes and be ready for battle, because it's coming. It's coming. So I've been through a lot. You're going to go through a lot more. Because that's the way life is, isn't it? Because as long as the devil is roaming about the face of the earth, it's going to be heartache, it's going to be problems, it's going to be trouble. It's going to be there. But God said, that's not going to affect you because I'm going to give you more. More peace, more grace. Believe in the promises of God. That's all he asks us to do, isn't it? That we believe and trust in him to be saved. And he's asking you now to believe and trust in him to carry you through life so that he can give you more. Let us pray. Father, help us pull the scales off our eyes. Help us to quit looking at you through the eyes of our flesh, but look at you through the eyes of our spirit. Father, help us see the truth. Help us allow your Holy Spirit to work in our life and be led by your Spirit so that we can experience the more. You want to give us more peace and more grace. Father, help us to be willing to accept that, to give in to you and quit fighting it. We pray for our nation, Lord, that there is a revival to come to Jesus after all this turmoil. We pray, Father, for revival because of what this virus has done. We pray, Father, that we take advantage as your people to share the love of Jesus, because we certainly have a Jesus problem out there in the world. That Jesus is not in everybody's heart. Father, help us to be who you want us to be. And we thank you for the wonderful name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to thank y'all for being here with us this morning. The elders are always available. If you need prayer or you have something going on you need to talk to us about, please do. Please do. We're servants for you. Be safe, be blessed, and we'll be back here next Sunday. You're dismissed.